Well, it's a book about sleep that will absolutely keep you awake at night. That's the thriller Matthew Blake has delivered. And we get to chat through today on QBD Crime Club. It's a lesson on the vagaries of the human psyche, wrapped up in a cracking tale of murder. Did she or did she know she did? Only Matthew knows. And he joins me now. Hello.
Hi. Thanks so much for having me on.
Oh my goodness, this book is so many things in one. Like it's so educational. It's a thriller. It's a freak you out at night book. Like you have packed a lot of things into one book.
Well, I hope so. Yeah. I mean, first and foremost, it's a roller coaster thriller ride with twists and turns and characters. But I hope the people who are interested in sleep and psychology and what they might do in the night, there's things about that too. And most of all, it's a discussion book. It's a sort of water cooler book where you're going to work the next day and you have an argument with your colleague about that twist or that character or what happened there. And I hope it provokes discussion and gets everyone talking.
I think it absolutely will on so many fronts, actually. I was thinking about this being a really interesting kind of ultimately book club book because there are so many conversation starters and, as you say, water cooler conversations as well. But before we get to know Anna O, we need to get to know you because before you stepped into this fiction realm, you were words and writing were a huge part of your life already.
Yeah, they were. So I was a political speechwriter and sort of bag carrier and assistant for about 10 years after university. So did all of that. And that was extremely good training, really. It was a bit like, I imagine training to be a journalist where you learn how to grab an audience's attention and keep people interested. And it was brilliant. But my aim was always to write books. And I was waiting until I had an idea big enough for a book and a sort of big book. And when I came across Sleep, I thought, Eureka, this is the moment.
Because it isn't, I mean, you've got that real trigger moment. You've got a story that came to you, but really you always thought there are books in me and I'm going to write.
Yes, I suppose so. I always wanted to have a go. Yeah, definitely. I mean, I grew up loving thrillers and mysteries, and I always remember reading The Murder of Roger Ackroyd, which is one of Agatha Christie's most famous mysteries, one of the most controversial twists in all of mystery fiction. And I remember when reading that as a teenager, I thought I'd love to write a book that one day had the same impact on an audience that left you at the final page sort of open mouthed. So I always wanted to have a go at that. And when I got the Sleep idea and I had the idea for the final huge twist, then I thought, you know, there's really something here.
And isn't that interesting? Because we'll get into it, but, you know, that impact that that book had on you.
Yeah.
In this book, there's that as well, that, you know, our main character wants to have that impactful book in time. So you've almost
Exactly.
Trained that, haven't you?
I did. There's a bit of autobiography in Ben, who's the main, he's the forensic psychologist, and he's desperately looking for his big break. And when he gets the case of Anna Rowe, that he thinks will make his career. So yeah, I mean, I was writing that while still doing all this other stuff. So definitely a bit of my own personal emotion came through there.
You've been a great researcher in your time, and there is so much of that that has gone into this. So yeah, it's a thriller. But the research behind this book, you must have spent a long time getting ready to get it to this.
Well, I did, yeah. So, I mean, it was 4 years from getting the first idea to the finished product. And I'd say at least 2 or 3 years of that was the research and the plotting and the planning. Obviously, it's a very high concept thriller about a, you know, people who commit murder while sleepwalking, and then the mystery illness called resignation syndrome. So the thing I was determined to do was that the reader would have to believe it could all happen. And so when I started doing all the research and I came across all these cases of things that actually happened, I thought, really, the truth is better than anything I could make up. So, and I've heard from lots of readers all around the world who've gone down sort of Google rabbit holes with this stuff and realized that they had absolutely no idea that all these medical mysteries were real things. So yeah, huge amount of research. And I think that's one of the things I love in thrillers, and I hope it's one of the things readers love.
So I guess give everyone that little tick. The thing that came to you was about 33 years of sleeping.
Yes. So that was, I came across that statistic and I thought, wow, that's a whole second life, really. That's a whole existence we very rarely talk about. But at the time I was thinking of it, there were a few sort of non-fiction books coming out about sleep, and in the newspapers, people, how do I get a better sleep? And, you know, it became something we were talking about in the sort of wider culture. So I think thrillers often sort of take that and tap into people's deepest fears. So I thought, well, what's the thing that might scare you most about sleeping? And it's what might you do that you're not conscious of doing? What if your nightmares weren't really nightmares at all? And so that's how I started discovering sleepwalking and these real life cases of people who commit murder while sleepwalking. Your eyes are open, but your brain's asleep. And it just blew my mind, really. I come from a sort of literature background. And when you come across all this stuff, you think, wow, it's quite a moment.
It's what I love, that premise that you began with, that you spend 33 years of our lives sleeping. It just, even that makes you think. And then you're like, okay, so it's no wonder we have such a fascination with sleep. I mean, next to, you know, the weather and how Man U's gone or whatever, like, it's the most talked about thing is sleep. And of course, these days, so much of health is linked to it, being weight, being gut health. Like, there is so much. So it's such a talked about topic. And then you've given us the dark side.
Well, I was looking for also something which I hoped would connect with readers across the world, really. And there's very few things that are genuinely universal. And sleep is the one thing all 8 billion of us on the planet do every night. So it's I've always been fascinated by it. I've always been interested in my own sleep, and which got worse, I must add, as I researched this book. The world of sleep, particularly sleep crime, and sleepwalking. I mean, people think that we're either awake or we're asleep, but actually our eyes can be open, we can look like we're functioning normally, but actually our brains are still asleep. And that's when some people do these terrible things, and the legal system has to figure out, did they mean to do it or did they not mean to do it?
And it's interesting, isn't it? Because most people have a sleepwalking story or a sleep talking story about someone in their family. And, you know, but it's usually something simple like going to the fridge or whatever. But the cases you go through and give us examples of, incredible documentation over time of most, be it driving, like most bizarre things that people do when they're
sleeping. There are. I mean, there's people who sort of mow their lawn naked at night while still asleep. I mean, people do the most extraordinary things. And I think what's scary about it, to be honest, is that the line between doing something comically silly while you're sleepwalking and absolutely awful is actually very, very slim. I mean, you can sort of turn from one to the other. Someone can, you know, try and wake you up, can try and bring you back, and you think you're being attacked, you're having a nightmare about that, and you lash out and you do something. So it's tapping into all those things. And I think everyone at some point has woken up with the memory of that nightmare still in their head. It's still more real than the real world. And I think a lot of people have thought, what have I done? And then you have that moment where it all goes, you realize that it was just a dream. But in the book, of course, it's not just a dream.
Absolutely not. And you know, that I just found so many elements of the information that you gave us along the way, like the most popular dreams in the world. I mean, I imagine even just going down those rabbit holes for you was pretty interesting.
It was. I mean, there's so much great stuff. I almost had to ration myself because I was going to end up being a part-time sleep therapist. So, the most popular dreams I personally have, you know, the running away dream, that sort of classic Hitchcock thing where you're running away from people chasing you. Other people have the exam dream where you haven't revised and you've got your exam tomorrow and you're going to fail. And what's amazing is these dreams crop up across the world. In every country, people have the same dreams, they have the same anxieties. And it says something about our psychology, our mental state, that we're all having these same dreams. And I think that's fascinating.
Absolutely. And you give us examples of trauma and things that have, awful situations that have happened to people, and how they lead to this resignation syndrome, which is what you talk about.
It is. And I think resignation syndrome is the most mysterious and mind-blowing mystery illness of all. It's when people literally fall into a deep sleep. We've all seen, you know, in myths and in fairy tales, people fall into a deep sleep. But scientists actually think people do genuinely fall into a deep sleep. And there's all these cases around the world, these sleeping sicknesses, where people fall into a sleep and can't be woken up for years on end. So that was absolutely incredible. That's there's a brilliant writer called Suzanne O'Sullivan who's written lots of nonfiction books on this. And it's just extraordinary when you start reading about the cases.
And that is where we meet Anna O, of course, because she is fast asleep when you introduce her to us. And the forensic psychologist who is charged with the case. I found it really interesting. The con I don't know if contradiction is the word, but of him, he's someone who just wants to help and be there and solve the mystery of this woman who's asleep. But then it's also, there's this sideline of how it will help his career, because this thing's sort of quite competitive. But when we first meet Anna, she's been asleep for quite a few years and supposedly has murdered a couple of people.
Yeah, she's become this sort of international true crime celebrity. So known by her social media handle at Anna O. And she killed her two best friends while sleepwalking and then never opened her eyes again. And she still hasn't woken up after 4 years. The government needs to put her on trial for the double murder. And they can't get anyone to wake her up. And Benedict Prince, who's the psychologist, has a sort of new method for trying to wake people's resignation syndrome up. And it's about restoring hope to their lives, which is the current theory about what causes sleeping sickness. And he needs to understand who Anna is, what led her to that terrible night, that terrible deed, and how he can wake her up from that and give her hope in the future. But as he does that, of course, he also discovers that the narrative that she did kill those two people might not be as simple as it seems. And there's lots of other secrets and mysteries hiding away that other people don't want to come out.
Now, he works at a clinic in London called the Abbey, the sleep clinic. It almost felt like, it's so clandestine, it almost felt like a CIA or an FBI or an MI5 kind of facility, didn't it? But it's for sleeping.
It is, and it's based on a real place. I mean, it's Harley Street, obviously, is the place in London where all the sort of the high net worths and all the celebs come and get all their treatments and all their private medical stuff. And I came across this real life sleep clinic in Harley Street and couldn't believe my luck. It was all there, and I just did my research and heard all these amazing stories about these people who come and they need treatment for sleep, but they don't want the world to know they're getting treatment for sleep. So whether it's sort of senior people across the world. And I thought, wow, that's what a setting for a psychological thriller.
And isn't that, again, just another example of our obsession with sleep and the importance of it, that people are so afraid of being judged for not being able to sleep that they have to hide it?
It is. And there's been cases I research, of people who are CEOs of multinational companies who have insomnia. And if they tell the world they've got insomnia, of course, the share price absolutely tanks. And news presenters who can't do their job because they have sleeping difficulties. And so, yeah, I thought it's this private secret world, but it's something we all face and something we can all relate to.
And I find it fascinating that it actually exists. And it is, as you, it is as secretive as it seems in the book.
It is, yeah. So it's because it's sort of expensive, and you know, you've got it, you only go there if you want the best people in the world and you've got a really serious problem. So yeah, they have to keep everyone's identity a bit secret and operate with discretion, I think is how they call it. So I'm proud of the fact that every single thing in the book has happened somewhere in the world. So nothing in it is made up, in effect, it's all possible.
I love that there's actually something quite academic about that. You know, you, and that's kind of you, right? Like you come from that incredible background. Anna O has a little bit of a similar academic background.
Yes, she does. Yes.
And so the factual stuff in it is, I don't know, it just adds weight and makes the story more interesting.
Well, I hope so. I mean, I think I was 12 or 13 when the Da Vinci Code came out and sort of took over the world, and everyone, that was the book across the world everyone was talking about, and the theories and the thing at the front, which was everything in here is real and true. And that was another sort of Agatha Christie moment for me. I just absolutely lapped that up and adored it. And I loved the way that you couldn't tell what was real and what was fiction. And that blending of the two things was just so sort of enticing as a thriller reader, I think. So yeah, I think I'd hope to take the same approach, where I have had some people actually ask me whether some of the fictional characters in it are real people, and I have to tell them that actually no. So they are made up, but all the science is true.
Benedict has a great mentor in Bloom, who we hear about through the book, and a unique sort of character, and you can imagine what type of actresses might play her. But a really important mentor who's very influential in this world and this space.
Exactly, yeah. And she's a bit more worldly wise than Ben. He's sort of on the make, where she's seen it all, done it all. She's the sort of the top sleep guru in the UK and, you know, around the world. And so yeah, she's the head of the Abbey. She's the one who calls him in and sort of hands him this Anarrow case. It's the sort of the most important and famous criminal true crime case in the world. And I won't spoil things to say that she becomes embroiled in the mystery in a very direct way.
Yeah, that's a very good way of saying it without actually saying it. I love you gave us a real insight also, and I'm sure this is real, to the different layers and levels of prejudice. So what would you say about, neurologists to psychologists to psychiatrists to, and there are definite kind of levels, and Ben quite really feels that, doesn't he?
He does, and I love that. I'm always trying to, having worked in politics and worked in small offices and seen the rivalries and the tensions, which I think everyone sees in their own workplaces, wherever you are. I think you get that everywhere, and you know, in a sleep clinic, you get that too. You get the neurologist and the psychiatrist who sort of think they're a bit above the psychologists and the sleep therapists. And there's all these rivalries going on, and yeah, I had great fun with that inter-office rivalry.
And it gives him, like, there are, he's so interesting as a character because there are times he's so smart and onto things, and other times when he's constantly doubting himself and he's got a broken a marriage and a little girl who he's wanting to do the right thing by. So you give us all these different kind of facets and flaws within his character.
Well, I'm fascinated by the idea of the psychologist who can cure everyone else but can't cure himself, you know, who sees what's wrong in everyone else's marriage or relationship or family life and yet struggles with his own. So yeah, Ben hasn't got all the answers. He's a man on the make professionally, but also someone trying to overcome the trauma of his divorce, the separation from his daughter, the sense that life is sort of falling apart. This is the case that will either sort of make him or break him. It's either he everything is on the line for him personally too.
You give us the story in from different characters' perspectives. I think I started off thinking, oh, it's just going to be Ben, and then someone else comes in. And throughout the book, different characters give us their views or perspectives, or you tell it in different ways. And it's such a good way to unravel the story, isn't it? Because you never quite know who's going to give you the next piece of information.
No, well, it's lots of short chapters, so I love I always love the sort of James Patterson thing, the 2.5 page chapters. You just get to the end and you can't wait for the next one. So yeah, lots of that, cliffhangers at the end of every scene. I hope for people who love, perhaps people who don't read too much and read, want a holiday read, want to sort of this is, if you like your Netflix crime dramas, this will have some of the same pace and interest and character and the short snappy scenes. And you don't know who you can trust, you don't know who's telling the truth. And you hear about Anna's notebook as she charts what led up to that terrible night. You hear about Ben, but also a lot of these other mysterious characters who are pivotal to the whole thing, but have even more mystery about them.
And I think that's the way we meet Anna, of course, is we know that she's fast asleep, but you give us her diary, and that is the thread that takes us through the book. And she actually becomes more fascinating as the book goes on because she comes from a world that you obviously know a lot about, a world of power and politics and institution.
And I think that's why her case has sort of caught the attention of the world, because she's such a fascinating character. She's a writer herself. She's you know, was very active on social media and everything before all this happened, and has now just become this sort of true crime celebrity. But as we go into her notebook, her private thoughts, her sort of darkest fears, if you like, about her own sleeping conditions, what she's capable of, we start to learn what really led up to that fatal night when her life changed forever, and the sort of the Anarrow phenomenon began.
It's interesting to see someone like that who is surrounded by seemingly good stuff, great life, wealthy parents, powerful parents, friends, and yet she was alone the whole time. She was dealing with a really serious sleep issue and quite traumatic stuff, and she had no one that she could turn to.
Well, that is fascinating. I think that's one of the contradictions. It's exploring that family dynamic. I think so many great relationships are all based on those sort of family feuds and family sort of arguments and fallings out. It's the core unit we can all identify with. And the Ogilvy family are just this fascinating family. They're sort of high powered but dysfunctional. And they've been unwittingly thrust into the public spotlight in the worst possible way. They're having to cope with that, which is a very modern problem. You know, every move is watched and their every comment is interpreted. And I'm really interested in what would it be like if that happened to your family? You know, what if you turned up one day and you saw on the front page of the newspaper your own daughter and your life was suddenly fair game for everyone? It's a terrifying thought, but, you know, I think we all fear it in some degree.
And you certainly, and that's part of it, isn't it? The social media, the everyone being kind of fair game, and also just the absolute mass attention to true crime, be it podcasts, books. It's just such a thing now. People are so fascinated by it. And that's very much what's at the heart of this.
It is. And I wanted it to be a book that was absolutely of the moment. You know, it was absolutely reflecting the world we're all living in. And TikTok and influencers and armchair detectives who go around to crime scenes now and descend on it with their phones, and that whole world, which has sort of both democratized that sleuthing and the detective, but not in a good way, really. And it looks at all those things, really. What would it be like to be caught up in that storm? And you know, we've all got these apps on our phone. We're all one click away from something like this happening to us. And it's a uniquely modern problem, but it's a terrifying one.
Absolutely. Can we sneak back to some of those crimes that you talked about when people are sleeping, and even resignation syndrome? I just found it fascinating, some of the examples you had of real stuff that's happened to entire groups of people.
It is amazing. I mean, the most famous example of the resignation syndrome, the sleeping sickness, is refugee children in Sweden who are faced with being deported back to their homeland, have been through huge amounts of trauma, and they basically resign from life. They basically give up all hope of life and fall into this deep sleep, which they can't be woken up from. There are other examples of small communities, example in Kazakhstan and then elsewhere around the world, where it's sort of infectious. You know, you're in a people around you start falling into this deep sleep, and it becomes this sort of societal thing, which is a fascinating idea, the way in which our minds influence our body. And when if we experience psychological trauma, it sort of manifests itself in physical symptoms. And I think so, yeah, the sleeping sicknesses are amazing real life things.
And you talked a lot when we talked about Ben and his role in all of this. He often talked about the mind as opposed to the brain. And that's just an interesting way of looking at it, isn't it?
It is. And I mean, I didn't, you know, it's obviously commercial fiction. It's thrilling. It's exciting. No one wants a sort of lecture on brain science. So, but I think all of us, you know, all of us wrestle with our minds. I mean, all of us wrestle with psychology and well-being and mental health and, you know, how we encounter the world. We can all identify with that. So I think the mind is probably more talked about now than ever before. It's our modern obsession about how we interact with the world and our mental well-being. And yeah, Ben is absolutely at the forefront of that.
Did you, in terms of your research, speak to psychologists, psychiatrists, and neurologists? I mean, did you have to go down all those paths to understand all those different roles?
I did, yeah. And it was fascinating seeing the different takes on things. I think what fascinates me about the psychology is that it's very autobiographical. It's very character-led. So it's figuring out what's going on in your life. You know, what's your relationship like? What's your work like? And it's all about character. And Ben's investigation into Anna's case is all about investigating a life, really. He's got to understand who she is. And I think that's what makes psychology so fascinating. But I did talk to neurologists, and there's one neurologist who said the most interesting thing, which was the only way you could tell if someone was sleepwalking when they commit a murder is if you attached electrodes to their head while they were murdering. That's the only way you could ever tell. So in all the criminal cases where someone claims they were sleepwalking, there is no actual medical way to tell whether they were sleepwalking or not. And that's scary, challenging, amazing. And there are cases going back hundreds of years of people who claim that they were sleepwalking when they committed these crimes.
And isn't it wild to think that all the advances in modern technology and that we haven't worked it out?
It's one of the few genuine mysteries. I think as a mystery writer, you're always looking for the things we still don't understand. And that's when we don't. We just don't, when we all go to sleep at night, you know, we still don't really understand what goes on, why we're dreaming what we dream, why we have that nightmare, why we, I mean, one of the things as I've gone around talking to readers across the world, really, is people start opening up about their own sleep experiences. And once one person starts, the whole table erupts with sleep eating, sleep talking, sleep walking, night terrors. Everyone's got a story about it. So it's tapping into that universal thing, and we can all relate to it.
And I just keep going back to what you said earlier about that wherever you are, wherever you're from, wherever, whatever culture you're from, that saying there are common themes of dreams. And that is just, it just says something about humanity, doesn't it?
It does, doesn't it? It really does. It's just, it's amazing. All the, you know, division and sort of conflicts and everything. And yet actually our minds are all, when we go to sleep, we all go to sleep and our minds are dreaming the same dreams and, you know, having the same aspirations and the same anxieties about our kids or our parents or our friends. And it's amazing, really.
And I haven't even talked about it, but I don't think people are going to be able to walk by this cover. It is absolutely spectacular, isn't it? Like, it's such a compelling shot.
It is. And I mean, it was very unusual because we got that cover. It was the only one ever done. And everyone agreed it was just an absolute knockout. And very unusually, every territory around the world, we're nearly over 40 now, has gone with the same cover, but with a different coloured O. So I've got a whole bookshelf with that eye and all these different coloured O's for all the translations. So it's amazing to have.
That is very cool indeed. So now you're a sleep guru. You're a sleep expert. What's next on the horizon, Matthew?
Well, I'm just doing edits on the next book, actually. So I was trying to find another subject that was as big and noisy and relatable as sleep. And I came across all this stuff about false memory and people suggesting about a third of our memories, our most treasured memories about falling in love or, you know, the last words of our parents actually didn't happen as we recollect them, and that we edit our memories every time we go and access them. So that again is fascinating. That was, there's almost even more stuff there than sleep. So it's about false memory, set in Paris. It's fast, it's pacey, and it should be out in 2025.
Oh, listen to you. Well, congratulations on Anna O. It's a fabulous title because it just drops off the tongue, and a fabulous image, and you've given us so much to think about. Thank you so much and congratulations.
Thank you so much, and thanks for having me.